We humans are the most intelligent creatures known to have ever appeared in the universe. What are humans made of? The human body is composed of organs, bones, blood, nerves, and more. Take one of the organs, the heart, and if we zoom into it deeply, we can see billions of cells. But the cell isn't its final stage. Again, if we zoom further into a singular cell, we'll end up with molecules. In just this one cell, there are millions of unique complex molecules. Take one of these molecules, zoom in even more, and finally we can see atoms. To put it simply, the human body consists of around 40 trillion cells, and a single cell contains approximately 100 trillion atoms. But atoms are not the end of the story. If we could magnify more, we would see clouds of electrons at the outer edge of the atom. And if we magnify again, we will end up with empty spaces. But let's not just stop here. If we keep zooming further, at the center of the atom, we would see the nucleus. Yes, the orbiting electrons and the nucleus are collectively called an atom. But again, the nucleus is not the end of the story. If we zoom further into the nucleus, we will see protons and neutrons sticking together. These are subatomic particles. Let's take one of the protons and again zoom into it. Inside the proton, we can see tiny dancing particles. These quarks, these tiny particles are called elementary particles or fundamental particles. Quarks are elementary particles, but there are a further total of 12 matter particles and 4 force carriers in the standard model of particle physics. So what classifies something as an elementary particle? If we look at the proton, it consists of 3 quarks. However, it's more precise to say quarks collectively form a proton rather than a proton contains 3 quarks. So protons are not elementary particles. They are subatomic particles. Elementary particles don't have any substructures and cannot be broken down into smaller components, which means they aren't made up of anything. These are the final and smallest known building blocks of our universe. The study of elementary particles is called particle physics. Studying and understanding these particles forms the foundation of both classical and quantum physics. So let's return to the standard model. There are 12 matter particles and 4 force carriers classified into 3 families: quarks, leptons, and bosons. Quarks and leptons are together called fermions. All elementary particles have 3 basic properties: mass, spin, and charge. If we look at the first particle, it has a mass of 2.4 mega electron volts divided by c squared. Mass of an elementary particle is mentioned as energy. It comes from Einstein's mass-energy equivalence equation, E is equal to mc squared. For example, if we convert 1 gram of mass into pure energy, it becomes 5.6 into 10 to the power of 31 mega electron volts. So from here we can compare the mass of this particle with 1 gram's energy. In the realm of particle physics, fermions are generally characterized by half-integer spins, while bosons typically possess integer spins such as 0, 1, or 2. However, be careful. Although we use the word spin, it's not the same as the spinning of a ball. First, we start with quarks. There are up quarks and down quarks, and each of them come in 3 generations. So in total, we have discovered 6 flavors of quarks. The up quark has a charge of +2/3, while the down quark carries a charge of -1/3. This same charge is continuous in their subsequent generations. There is no major difference between the generations, though each generation tends to be heavier than the previous one. We've already heard that a proton has a positive charge. That charge is simply composed from the charges of the quarks. A proton is composed of 2 up quarks and 1 down quark. So the combination of charges comes as +2/3, +2/3, -1/3, which is a total of +1. Similarly, a neutron is composed of 1 up quark and 2 down quarks, and the combination of charges -1/3, -1/3, +2/3 totals 0. So the neutron comes with neutral charge. The combination of 3 quarks is called a baryon. Therefore, protons and neutrons are baryon particles. Now we can see that the same flavor of quarks exist in a single baryon particle. For example, a proton has 2 up quarks. Now, how do we distinguish them? That's where an additional property comes into play, which is the color charge property. And how do these 3 quarks bind together? It's also related to the color charge property of quarks. Each flavor comes in three colors, red, blue, and green. However, don't let these colors mislead you. Quarks are much too small to be visible, and thus could never have a visible property like color. The names were chosen because of a convenient analogy. In a proton, there are three quarks, one of each color, and they constantly exchange colors among themselves. But how do they exchange colors and interact? That's where the messenger particle, or force carrier, gluon, comes into play. Quarks are able to change their color during their interactions. The gluon acts as a messenger particle, carries a color charge from one quark to another, and facilitates interactions between quarks. So gluons hold quarks together by exchanging color charges. Since gluons are massless, they exchange colors between quarks at near the speed of light. However, the same color cannot exist simultaneously in two quarks. For example, in a proton, if one quark has a red color, the remaining two quarks will have green and blue. If one quark has a green color, the other two quarks will have red and blue. Thus, three quarks in a baryon particle always have different colors by exchanging gluons. If we combine the red, blue, and green colors, we end up with no color. Therefore, the proton is a colorless particle. All baryon particles are colorless. We've already heard about the strong nuclear force. That force is simply the color charge that involves the exchange of gluons between quarks, binding quarks together and creating the strongest force in the universe. Even though it's the strongest force, its range is only a few femtometers. One femtometer equals 10 to the power of minus 15 meters. We've already seen that protons have a positive charge, but how do protons stick together in the nucleus? While the same electric charges repel each other, and opposite charges attract each other. This is also caused by the strong nuclear force. The strong nuclear force can exist within the range of a few femtometers. While the size of a proton is less than one femtometer, the strong force also leaks outside the proton. This strong force overcomes the electromagnetic force, so do protons stick together instead of repelling each other. If we try to kick out a quark from a baryon, it requires a lot of energy. Gluons are constantly exchanged between quarks and create a tube-like structure. This tube is very strong. When providing energy to try to eliminate one quark from a baryon, it acts like a spring or rubber band. The more energy given to pull the quark, the stronger it becomes. But anyhow, if we provide enough energy to remove a quark instead of kicking it out from the baryon, it creates a new quark and anti-quark pair. This pair is called a meson. This is how these new particles form, and where E is equal to mc squared comes into play. The energy used to expel the quark from the baryon is converted into mass, so the extra energy creates a meson. However, mesons decay quickly. The exchange of mesons between two baryons is also responsible for same-charged protons and neutrons stick together in the nucleus. However, we have never found an isolated quark or a particle with four quarks. And another thing, if we calculate the mass of all three quarks, which exist in a proton, they appear to constitute only 1% of the proton's whole mass. So where does the proton get this extra mass from? Well, gluons are massless and interact at nearly the speed of light. The energy between quarks converts into mass when we measure it. So far, we've looked at quarks, gluons, and the strong force, which are responsible for creating the nucleus of the atom. However, an atom contains both a nucleus and electrons. So what is an electron? In the standard model of particle physics, in the group of fermions, there is another family called leptons. This family includes the electron among a total of six particles, the electron, the neutrino, and their next generation particles. Electrons have a charge of negative 1, while neutrinos have no charge. So we can divide leptons into two categories. The charged leptons, which have a negative charge, electrons, muons, and taus, and the neutral leptons, which carry no charge, electron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and tau neutrinos. The electron is the only member of a family of leptons which is involved in the formation of atoms. Quarks exist only as composite particles with other quarks, while leptons are individual particles. The size and mass of an electron are very small, approximately 9 into 10 to the power of minus 31 kilograms or 0.5 mega electron volts. However, neutrinos are extremely small, being millions of times smaller than electrons. That's why neutrinos rarely interact with matter. Even though trillions of neutrinos pass through our bodies every second, they are undetectable by modern methods due to their size. Therefore, the neutrino is one of the least known first-generation particles. Let's return to the topic of electrons. Electrons orbit the nucleus like clouds due to their wave behavior, but at different energy levels. Electrons carry a negative charge, and all charged particles have an electric field. As we already know, protons have a positive charge, so protons are also charged particles. Then what is the electromagnetic force? Quarks constantly engage gluons, which are responsible for quarks sticking together, generating a strong force. Similarly, when two charged particles come close to each other, they exchange virtual photons and create electromagnetic force. These are called virtual photons because their energy cannot be detectable. The exchange of virtual photons between charged particles is the reason why particles of the same charge repel each other, and particles with opposite charges attract each other. Unlike virtual protons, there are real photons that also carry electromagnetic fields, which can be detectable. This is light. We've already seen electrons orbiting nuclei at different energy levels. When an electron jumps to a lower energy level, it emits a tiny packet of electromagnetic radiation, a photon. It has no mass and travels at the speed of light. But why do electrons jump between energy levels? Electrons orbit at their own energy levels, but when electrons gain energy, it jumps to a higher energy level. However, it is always trying to remain in its original orbit state, so it quickly jumps back to the normal state. As a result, it releases its excess energy, a photon. Jumping between the distances or energy levels determines the wavelength of light. So far, we have seen quarks, leptons, and their force carriers. The strong force is responsible for binding quarks together, and also for binding the nucleus. Photons act as a force carrier between charged particles, creating the electromagnetic force. The resulting nucleus and electrons attract each other, eventually forming a complete atom. The electromagnetic force is also stronger, but it can never overcome the strong nuclear force. The strong force needs to be strong to overcome the electromagnetic repulsion between the positively charged photons in the nucleus. If it were weaker than the electromagnetic force, no atoms with more than one proton in the nucleus would be able to form. Now we only have two force carriers left in the standard model, so what is the use of these? It's not very familiar to us, but it's as important as the other forces. The weak force. In nature, everything seeks a stable position. So the atom also. What is an unstable atom? In an atom, when the number of protons exceeds the number of neutrons, or the number of neutrons exceeds the number of protons, the atom becomes unstable. This unstable atom will constantly try to achieve a stable state. So the extra neutron converts into a proton to maintain the stability of the atom. But how can the neutron convert? We've already seen that the neutron is a combination of quarks, two down quarks and one up quark, and the proton is a combination of two up quarks and one down quark. So when a neutron converts into a proton, a down quark changes into an up quark. If we look deeply, the down quark has a charge of -1/3, and the up quark has a charge of +2/3. So if the down quark changes into a up quark, it needs to gain +1 charge. So in order to do that, the down quark emits a W- boson and becomes an up quark. The W- boson has a charge of -1. So the charge is conserved during this process, but that boson decays very quickly into an electron and an antineutrino pair. An electron has a charge of -1 and an antineutrino which has no charge. This is called beta-minus decay. But what is an antineutrino? It's an antiparticle. Yes, the fermion group has 12 matter particles and also a reactionary 12 antiparticles. The main difference between particles and antiparticles is their opposite charge. For example, electrons have a -1 charge, but anti-electrons have a +1 charge. The other name for an anti-electron is positron. However, neutrinos have no charge and it remains at zero. So in order to distinguish between neutrino and anti-neutrino, the lepton numbers come into play. Similarly, when a proton converts into a neutron, the up quark becomes a down quark. In order to gain the negative charge, it emits a W+ boson. This boson quickly decays into a neutron and a positron, which is called beta+ decay. Without this decay process, hydrogen atoms cannot form helium atoms, and we can't get energy from this process, which means nuclear fusion would never occur in stars. In our sun, hydrogen atoms turn into helium atoms. This process provides our Earth with energy, which is essential for the formation and sustenance of life and everything else. The same weak force is responsible for nuclear fission. Nuclear fission is when large atoms split into two atoms or release a daughter atom. The other boson involved in the weak interaction is the Z boson. When a particle and an antiparticle collide, it emits a Z boson, and similar to the W boson, the Z boson decays very quickly, producing another particle and antiparticle pair. The Z boson's charge is zero, so it only happens between a pair of particles and antiparticles. The particle and antiparticle pairing together results in a zero charge. For example, an electron has a -1 charge, and a positron has a +1 charge. So together they become zero charged, the Z boson. And if we look at the meson, it contains one quark and an antiquark, so it decays into a Z boson, and quickly becomes other particles. The reason why W and Z bosons decay quickly is because of their mass, which is very high compared to fermions. But why is it called a weak force? Because its range is very, very small, smaller than a proton. If we look deeper in the standard model, our first generation particles, gluons and photons, have a long time life. A proton has a lifespan of 10 to the power of 34 years, and an electron 6.6 into 10 to the power of 28 years. On the other hand, W and Z bosons have a lifetime of just 10 to the power of minus 25 seconds, and the second generation particle, the muon, lasts 10 to the power of minus 6 seconds. So due to their very short lifetimes, these are only detectable in particle accelerators. Only the first generation particles are involved in forming most of the matter in the universe. However, we can create baryon particles made up of the second or third quarks. But these all have a much greater mass and decay very rapidly into protons and neutrons. However, we don't yet know exactly why the remaining two generation particles exist and quickly end their lifetimes. And the other one that has a place in the standard model is the Higgs boson, or the Higgs field, which is believed to be responsible for the mass of an elementary particle and the Z and W bosons. That's why it's called the God particle. But it's still a mystery. Not just the Higgs boson, but also all elementary things. To date, more than 20 Nobel Prizes have been awarded in the field of particle physics. This means that every discovery in particle physics is new to us. So far, we've looked at the strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces. However, our universe has four fundamental forces, the fourth one being gravitational force. Scientists are trying to add an imaginary particle called graviton to the standard model, which may be responsible for gravitational force. But they are failing because we have, as yet, been unable to find a force carrier responsible for gravitational force. Gravitational force acts as an infinite range, so it's believed that imaginary bosons will have zero mass and be smaller than neutrinos. We have a long way to go to understand this. However, scientists on the Earth are becoming cleverer and trying to understand how the universe works at a quantum level. For now, the only way to understand the universe is to study those point-like things, and one day we will understand everything before the aliens teach it to us.